Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Folly by Laurie R. King, narrated by Frank Muller. This work is copyrighted 2001 by Laurie R. King. This recording is copyrighted 2001 by Recorded Books. The novel begins with the following definition from Webster's Ninth New Collegiate Dictionary. Folly, from Old French, fol, fool. 1. Lack of good sense or normal prudence and foresight. 2. A foolish act or idea. 3. Evil, wickedness, criminally or tragically foolish actions or conduct. 4. An excessively costly or unprofitable undertaking. 5. An often extravagant, picturesque building erected to suit a fanciful taste. And now, Folly.
Preface. The gray-haired woman stood with her boots planted on the rocky promontory and watched what was left of her family pull away. The Orca Queen's engines deepened as the boat cleared the cove entrance, and its nose swung around, a magnet oriented toward civilization. Go, she told them silently. Don't slow down, don't even look back, just leave. But then Petra's jacketed arm shot out from the boat's cabin, drab and shapeless and waving a wild adolescent farewell. Rae's own hand came up in an involuntary response to wave her own goodbye, except that in the air her wave changed, the hand reaching forward, stretched out in protest and cry for help, as if her outstretched fingers could pull them back to her, as if she were about to take off down the beach, scrambling desperately over rocks and water to call and scream, "Don't leave me here! I'm so afraid!" And she caught the gesture before any of the three people on the boat could notice it, snapped the offending arm down to her side, and stood at rigid attention. The boat rounded the end of the island and was gone. Thank God they didn't see that, Rae thought. The last thing I want is for Tamara to think I don't know what I'm doing. So why do I feel like some ancient grandmother in one of those harsh nomadic tribes left behind on the icy steppes for the good of the group? I chose this. I wanted this. The engine's growl softened with the distance, grew faint, then merged into the island hush. No low mutter of faraway traffic, no neighbors, dogs, and children, not even the pound of surf in this protected sea. A small airplane off to the north, the rusty wheel squeak of a bird, the patter of tiny waves, and silence. Alone at last, for better or for worse, solitude and silence. Silence was not an absence of noise. It was an actual thing, a creature with weight and bulk. The stillness felt her presence and gathered close against her. Slowly at first, but inexorably, until Rae found herself bracing her knees and swaying with the burden. It felt like a shroud, like the sodden sheets they used to bind around out-of-control mental patients. She stood alone on the shore, head bowed, as if the gray sky had opened to give forth a viscous and invisible stream of quiet. It poured across her scalp and down her skin, pooling around her feet, spreading across the rocks and the bleached driftwood, oozing its way into the salt-stunted weeds farther up the bank and the shrubs with their traces of spring green, then fingering the shaggy trunks of the fragrant cedars and bright madronas until it reached the derelict foundation on which 52-year-old Rae Newborn would build her house. That brush-deep, moss-soft, four-square, twin-towered stone skeleton that had held out against storm and fire and the thin ravages of time, waiting 70 years for this woman to raise its walls again. Or not. This could easily prove a farce, a tragic folly demanding the effort and expense of a moonshot without a board ever going up. That garish blue tarpaulin covering her pricey lumber might prove her memorial, and Folly would have another chapter added to its already colorful history. Rae found that her right hand had wrapped itself around the opposite wrist, its thumb tracing the crisscrossed scars on the tender and vulnerable skin. She tipped her palms back and let the sleeves fall away, and studied closely the raised lines, as if a message might be read there. One pair of scars had lived on her wrists for 30 years, but she could still recall the rich well of blood, the overwhelming relief, and the astonishing absence of pain. The slightly longer pair that overlaid them were 10 years younger, not much pinker, and less clear in her mind. But on top of that set, the most recent cuts were still bright and sharp. Almost exactly a year old, those. The scars held a macabre fascination, even during those blessedly long periods in her life when Rae had no desire to add to them. The intriguing dichotomy of the toughness of human skin and its defenseless parting, the body's grim determination to heal itself, the physical proof of how painful life could become, all drew her gaze. Most of all, though, she was constantly astonished, and even more, grateful, that in all that self-mutilation, she'd never managed to slice through anything essential to the working of the hand. Perhaps there was a message to be read on the skin. Next time, use the gun, stupid. At that reminder, Rae dropped her hands and raised her eyes to the campsite, searching for the green knapsack that held, among her other most secret and treasured possessions, the wood-grip revolver that had been the reason for her recent long drive up the coast. As Tamara had pointed out more than once, a plane flight would have been easier on everyone else. But they don't allow guns on a plane. She spotted the lump of green nylon on top of the heap of possessions that had come with her on the Orca Queen out of Friday Harbor, piled there by Petra and Tamara and Ed De La Torre, left for Rae to sort and arrange. In those haphazardly stacked boxes were tools and toilet paper, canned goods and dry socks, everything a maroon sailor or woodworker could ask for. At least the tarp that protected them from the drizzle, strung between tent and trees as an impromptu outdoor room, was a drab and inoffensive brown. Rae's gaze continued on, traveling from the shiny new camp equipment arranged at one side of the clearing to the two stone towers struggling out of the vegetation 200 yards away. The towers were the only visible parts of what had once been a house, and they seemed to tug at her mind and at her hands, willing her to draw near. A house is an exercise in controlled tension, she mused. Who had said that? Whoever it was, they'd slightly missed the point. A house, she reflected, is more an exercise in using tension to control compression. It's not tension that needs controlling, lest it pull a house to pieces, but gravity that threatens to push a building apart, its compression buckling walls and cracking foundations. Without the tension of a structure's key elements, collar ties to keep the roof rafters from splaying, floor joists to transfer the compression of sofas and grand pianos and running children and lovemaking couples into the tension along its lower edge, the house curls up in a heap and dies. The hunter must have come up with that idea of a house as a symbol of controlled tension, Rae decided. The succinct but inaccurate phrase had all the earmarks of one of the woman's psychiatric aphorisms, applying the gravity of a thoughtful statement to counteract the stresses threatening to pull a patient to bits. Rae herself would have put it, a house is an illustration of the power of tension. Take a saw to the bottom edges of that floor joist, remove the tension of stretched fibers below and leave only the compression of gravity above, and the piano or the sofa or the lovemaking couple drops through into the cellar. The use of tension, after all, was precisely what Rae was doing here, on this last island before an international border, a middle-aged woman with too much scar tissue and too long a history of psychiatric fragility, a mad woman with a canvas tent, a supply of food, a bag of pills that would stupefy half of Seattle, a huge tarpaulined heap of building materials, and one small boxed collection of simple hand tools with which to tame it. No assistance, no neighbors, no electricity. No telephone to cry for help. and a massive, sodden blanket of solitude dropped across her shoulders, threatening to flatten her if she dared move. The hunter called it depression and prescribed pills and talk. But it was compression. Its huge weight had crushed a marriage, ruptured the relationship with a daughter, and accompanied Rae to the doors of death 3 times. She knew in her bones, and with 30 years' intimacy with clinical depression, that for her the only way to counteract it was to use tension, psychic collar ties, to keep the weight of her life from splaying her out and collapsing her in a heap. Fear was the only tension powerful enough to counteract the weight of the illness. Not happiness, not work, not even love, but fear confronted, fears real and imagined. It had been the pursuit of fear that brought her here to the ends of the earth, where it was going to be easy, so infinitely easy, just to step off. Here on the edge of the world, on a narrow precipice above the final abyss, Rae Newborn had come to make her half-hearted stand. No safety net, no other to take responsibility, just Rae and her ghosts and demons. She had come here because she was tired, not of life itself, but of living between. She had come to a place whose very name was folly, as a way of forcing the issue. Rae had come here to meet her fear, to welcome it, and if possible, to use it. If that high-strung tension failed to balance the weight of life, if she was pulled to pieces or crushed flat, well, at least a decision would have been reached. The relief from the uncertainty would be considerable. She hadn't told Dr. Hunt any of this, of course. The hunter had problems enough with Ray's loopy self-diagnosis and had vehemently disapproved of her patient's self-prescribed plan of treatment, which amounted to recovery through hard labor. After all, Rae had entered the hospital in a state so low that she'd actually had to improve before she could attempt suicide. And although Dr. Hunt had seen the symbol of house building when it appeared in Ray's therapeutic sessions halfway through the year of her hospitalization as a sign of great hope, when it had dawned on the good doctor that Rae intended an actual physical act of construction, she had been, professionally speaking, appalled. Was this not just another attempt at suicide, a substitution of lumber on a lonely hillside for sharp blades in the bath? Rae did not argue with the hunter. How could she? At the same time, once the hospital staff agreed that she was no longer a danger to herself or to others, neither did Rae back down from her decision. Planning and gathering her strength, she waited out the remainder of the winter in the house of her combination nurse and babysitter. Then, when spring began, she packed her bags, ordered her lumber, arranged for her babysitter to drive her north, and prepared to step into the renovation process that a far different Rae Newborn had begun several years before. Although the process now had 2 enormous differences. She was on her own, not one of a family of 3, and in her knapsack she carried a gun. A beautiful gun, with a worn rosewood grip that endeared itself to Ray's hand, as old as the hills but impeccably maintained, solid and efficient as its 6 trim bullets. Not that she would need more than 1. Blades, she had decided, those exquisitely sharp and sophisticated scraps of steel that dominated her working life, did not belong here. 2, there would be no slow seeping out of life with a bullet. Final, like the solid slam of a well-hung door. The elegant old handgun lay at the bottom of the frayed knapsack that had belonged to Alan, and which still gave out the occasional grain of sand from one or another of the beach treks of his youth, wrapped inside one of Alan's flannel shirts, nestled beneath a portable tape player which the then 11-year-old Petra had produced when she discovered that her grandmother was hearing voices, and a couple of paperbacks Rae didn't know if she would ever get around to reading, under the leather-bound journal that was intended to be her substitute for psychiatric honesty, the white paper bag of substances intended to be her substitutes for psychiatric balance, and the plastic zip bag of soil and ashes that contained the remnants of her life in California. On the very top of the knapsack's contents rode her much-used carpenter's apron, the leather tool belt that Alan had given her, half-joking, for their first anniversary 9 years before. For some minutes now, Rae had been standing in the mist-like drizzle, her face turned to the building site, but her eyes and mind far away. A distant boat horn blared, and she twitched. With a deep, long drawing in of breath, such as that taken by a waking sleeper or a diver preparing to go under, she turned her head to look back at the heap of her possessions, and moved at last. She made her way along the rocks, past the tarpaulined lumber and through the campsite, to duck under the brown tarp and stand before her pile of boxes and cartons. She stretched out her hand and laid cold fingers on the bindings of the green knapsack. Part 1. Clearing the Ground. Anger did not begin to describe it. Rage, perhaps, or fury. Yes, like a furious sea pounding against his very bones. It surged and rocked him, this outrage at having what was his, stolen by another. Outwardly he appeared calm, lashing out from time to time, but no more than usual. His mind was in full control, plotting cold revenge and the retrieval of what belonged to him. The thief would have to flee a lot farther than some obscure island in the far reaches of the country to find any real refuge. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. 1. In fact, Petra had not been the only passenger of the Orca Queen to look back at the sole resident of Folly Island. Petra Collins, last scion of the once illustrious newborn line, certainly looked the longest and waved the hardest at her beloved, bereft grandmother, standing alone on the receding shore. The gel that spiked Petra's dark curls felt frozen onto her knit cap, and the puffy coat wrapping her slim, hard body was not really adequate. Poor, poor Gran, the child thought. She looks so lonely. Oh, man, I wish I was as brave as she is, all alone on an island with nobody to talk to except the seagulls, not even a dog. I mean, I might think about it if I could take Bounce along like that book we read a couple of years ago about the boy who runs away to go live in a dead tree in the woods and makes friends with a raccoon and a falcon. I wonder if Gran's island has raccoons. A falcon would be so cool, though. Oh, poor Gran. I wish I could stay with her a while. Oh, geez, it's cold. I wish I'd bought her that other hat. $5 more, but it would have been warmer for her. She looks so old and cold. And bye, Gran. Bye. Bye. The thoughts rattling through the mind of Tamara Collins were even less coherent than those of her 13-year-old daughter. She was struggling irritably to get her cigarette lit against the wind that flung the lighter's flame wildly about. On the way over, that wind had made her eyes water so badly she was now without any mascara, and she knew she looked a sight. Not that there was anyone to see her in this godforsaken hole. She finally got the cigarette going, and an instant before the boat rounded Folly's southeastern point, Tamara glanced involuntarily over her shoulder at her mother, standing proud and straight-backed on the promontory. A pang of sympathy, even pity, sneaked in, before her mind came back online with, "Damn it! How long can it be before you get a call from the police or a hospital asking, 'Do you know a Rae Newborn? She was found...'" Pick one or more of the following. A. Raving at passersby. B. Starving to death. C. Bleeding to death. Oh, God. Maybe Don was right and we really ought to do something about her. But that psychiatrist of hers said Mom has the right to do things that look crazy so long as they don't endanger her or anyone else. But how can this not be considered dangerous? I mean, in this day and age, what's to stop some nut, some real nut, some violent nut, from walking onto the island and, oh, this is going nowhere. I'll have to have another talk with that psychiatrist, Hunt, Dr. Hunt, and tell her exactly what the situation is here. She can't have any idea. Yes, Don is right. There's too much at stake, and I never should have allowed Petra to skip a day of school to come on this fool's errand. She's too young to understand, and it's a mother's responsibility to protect her daughter. Just because my mother never did, that doesn't mean... Oh, be fair. She couldn't help herself. She never meant to abandon. But if she's not responsible for her actions, if she wasn't responsible 30 years ago, and she wasn't last year either... Then why should she be allowed to do this completely irrational? I mean, they'd restrain some delusional person setting off for China in a rowboat. How is this any different? But no, Mom's not insane, and certainly not like that just because she has been in the past. But this really is crazy. Well, not crazy insane, but surely nuts. And especially when there's so much at stake. Don was right about that. And would it really be so bad if we were to take the reins, like he says, take the reins of the estate and give her a monthly allowance and for sure keep a close eye on her? I mean, what if she decided to give it all away or something? What about Petra? And there Mom stands, straight as an arrow, all pride and stubbornness, and damn it, why do I always have to pick up the pieces for her? She's the mother, for Christ's sake. It doesn't drive me crazy. It makes me so angry. Something's got to be done here. It's just too much. It's just... With that, the tree-covered island rose up and swallowed her mother, and Tamara was looking at nothing more exasperating than island and sea. She did not even know if what she felt was relief or sorrow. The third party on the Orca Queen was its owner, Ed De La Torre, waterborne taxi and delivery service, amateur philosopher, jack of all trades, particularly those trades frowned upon by the law. Ed was more or less impervious to the cold, his skin so toughened by sun and wind it wore like leather. Even the long white mustaches, startling against the deep brown of his face, seemed barely to move in the gusts. Impervious. That was how Ed saw himself. And with that thought, Ed, too, cast his sea-blue eyes back for a final glimpse of the odd figure he deposited on the shore of the uninhabited rock, a figure so lanky and so bundled up against the cold that a man couldn't even be sure of its sex. All alone, with no boat and fast-moving water all around, and what would that be like, living with nobody but the birds, no roof but the sky? Old Henry David would have understood, but then he could walk into town, talk to his neighbors, even had family practically within shouting distance. Hell, I've lived on the Queen for weeks at a time, but I can't remember ever going more than 2 or 3 days without stopping in at a bar or a marina or something. Thomas Merton, now maybe there was a man who'd explain the attraction. It's been a while since I read Merton. Maybe I'll dig him out again, see what the crazy monk has to say about solitude. Of course, even Merton didn't do that great with solitude. It distracted him, made him forget about the possibility of bad wiring in third-world appliances, so he got careless and electrocuted himself. You could say his solitude killed him. God knows it'd kill me. Alone, at last. Ray stood beneath the sagging tarpaulin roof, the knapsack gaping open in front of her, and raised her head, abruptly aware of the sheer size of all that solitude pressing in on her flimsy shelter. For the first time, the first of many, she well knew, cold fear trickled into her heart. What the hell am I doing? I mean, I've done a lot of loony things, but this really takes the cake. I should have been locked up. They should have thrown away the key. How can I possibly... She brought herself up short. This was no way to begin. She'd known it would be hard, but hard was the only solution. Distraction, Ray. Keep moving. Like the old World War I song said, bristling with dark trench humor, keep your head down, boys, and sing. Stop to rest, pause to straighten your back, and a sniper will get you for sure. So keep your head down, Ray, and work. First things first. She reached into the knapsack and pulled out the topmost object, her tool belt, stiff with long disuse. Absently, automatically, for the first time in a year and a half, her hands wrapped the belt around her waist and buckled it. And only when she noticed what she had done did Ray pause to reflect that although her first thoughts on the island had been of self-destruction, her first act seemed to be one of building. Dr. Hunt would approve. The psychiatrist might not, however, approve as wholeheartedly of Ray's next action, which was to take out the self-sealing sandwich bag filled with dark soil that she had collected from the center of the Redwood Cathedral where Alan and Bella's ashes had been scattered. The gray ash of them was no longer visible among the duff. Ray couldn't even make out any of the fragments of cremated bone that she knew were there, but sight did not matter. She went to the front of the tent, studied the possibilities for a minute, and then walked through the sodden grass of the clearing to the wide-spreading madrona tree that marked the eastern edge of clear ground. With the heel of her boot, Ray pounded a shallow depression into the damp soil, and there she emptied the contents of the bag. When every grain was gone, she kicked the mixture of island sand and half-rotted madrona leaves back over the foreign soil, then squatted down to smooth and pat it with her hand. To have come here without something of them would have been unthinkable. But they were here now, one responsibility that she was free of. Rae felt as if she should say something, if only to give a welcome. But with all the words that had been said over those two, it seemed unnecessary, and at the moment more effort than she could summon. It had been a long 2 days' drive up the coast with her nurse-come-babysitter, and an even longer 7 hours in the company of her daughter. Rae still did not know why Tamara had gone to all that trouble involving their crack-of-dawn flight to Seattle, a 2-hour drive to Anacortes in a rental car, the ferry crossing, and then Ed's boat, an hour unloading and standing around in the rain, and now the same journey in reverse. And for what? Because Tamara felt she was saying a final goodbye to her mother? And if that was the case, why didn't she at least hug Rae back there on the dock? Rigid and unyielding, that was Ray's daughter's attitude toward Rae, had been since Tamara was tiny. Rae knew she was to blame for abandoning the child to a rigid and unyielding grandmother, and why had thoughts of Tamara intruded on a memorial for Bella and Alan? Because Rae was tired, she supposed. She had done nothing in particular to wear herself out, mostly sat and stared at a lot of scenery, but she felt absolutely exhausted. She also felt vaguely aware that she had eaten nothing that day other than a dutiful piece of toast on the ferry. Food, however dismal the prospect, might be a good next step. Food was a habit, without savor and unworthy of any more consideration than shoes on her feet or a daily swipe of the toothbrush, but a recognized necessity, something to put in the stomach to delay the grave for a few more hours. Starving herself to death had never appealed. She went back to the tarpaulin room and the knapsack, drawing out the box of matches Tamara had given her. Tamara was smoking again, but Rae had not commented, and the Seattle newspaper that she had picked up on the ferry and went to fight silence with fire. First construction, now warmth, she thought. Surely these were both positive symbols. And if Ray's eyes lingered on the newsprint, first an article about a deadly crash and then one concerning a missing girl in Spokane, she caught herself before she could start to obsess over the sick fascination of other people's catastrophes. She briskly crumpled the pages into the center of the circle of ancient fire-blackened stones that Petra had regrouped for her and arranged a handful of kindling on top. A match to the corner and the daily news began to burn. Once the fire was going, Rae placed the heavy iron grill on the stones. Pawing through the box labeled food, she came up with a can of chili. Utensils gave her a saucepan, can opener, and spoon. She scooped the beans out into the pan and set it on the grill, which promptly tipped, spilling half the pan's contents into the flames. She rescued what she could, seated the grill more firmly on the stones, replaced the saucepan over the flames, and then carried the kettle over to her water jug to fill it. She brought the kettle back to the fire, and as she was lowering it over the hottest part of the flames, a blue jay screamed directly over her head. She jumped violently. A gout of water shot across the carbonized beans, nearly extinguishing the fire. Rae suppressed the high keen of frustration growing in her throat and gathered together a second batch of kindling. While her unappetizing meal warmed, Rae took out a plastic trash bag and began to clear away the litter she'd spotted, spoor of illicit picnickers and campers over the years. She used a rubber kitchen glove to pick up the beer cans and food wrappers, but at the sight of a Diet Coke can, she was suddenly seated on the ferry again, across the wide table from Tamara. Neither woman noticed the heavy rumble of the boat or the appearance and retreat of the mist-shrouded islands of the San Juan chain, for Tamara had brought an oversized manila envelope from the shoulder bag she carried and emptied it out with a jerk onto the worn plastic surface. "These should be the last of the receipts," she told her mother. "Anything else that arrives, I'll just readdress to your lawyer. And we sent her a notarized letter to say that we were no longer responsible for paying your bills. Here's your checkbook. You're sure you don't want me to hang on to it for you in case?" Tamara could not have caught the brief, cynical question that passed through her mother's mind as Rae took the checkbook, speculating about how Don would lay his hands on the family monies without it. Then she corrected herself. Outright theft was not Don's way. Whatever was missing, a careful adding up of numbers would not reveal it. I'll leave you as a signatory on the account, but I don't think you'll need to do anything. I really appreciate all you've done, Tamara. I know it's been a pain. We were happy to do it. It was always we with Tamara. She began to slide the papers back into the envelope. Was the drive up okay? Long, but good. It's beautiful countryside. You should have flown. I had too much stuff, Rae told her, giving the ready excuse. Too much stuff, too many phobias, too great a need for a firearm. How is Don? She asked dutifully. He's fine. There's a new health club open up that he joined. He says he's getting out of shape. The thin horsewoman picked up her Diet Coke and took a swallow. Rae would have been just as happy were Don to be struck down by a massive coronary, but again she took care not to show the thought. Before she could dredge up another topic of conversation, however, Tamara went on, looking over the top of the can at the shivering figure leaning on the boat's rail outside the window. I think it's Petra driving up his blood pressure myself. Are they having problems? Oh, you know, teenagers. Don was talking the other day about a special school, one of those highly structured environments. I told him this was a temporary thing. Her best friend just moved away and she's upset. Petra will settle down. Rae chose her words with care. My father was sent off to military school when he was 8. For some boys it may have worked fine, but he never really got over it. Those schools have a way of making things worse. You might find you've alienated her completely. Then, before Tamara could react to the unasked-for advice, Rae continued. What about another round of therapy? She might just need someone outside the picture to talk to. I was thinking about that, Tamara said, an enormous admission considering her loathing of anything connected with the taint of mental illness. The problem is we're going through a tight spot, and the insurance says let me cover it. Rae flipped open the checkbook and took out a pen, adding enough zeros to the sum to shut up Don's talk about private schools, which they couldn't afford anyway by the sound of it. She tore the check out and put it down in front of Tamara, thinking, well, that answers my question about how Don will manage without my checkbook. Petra tapped on the ferry's salt-smeared window then, gesturing to Rae about the passing scenery, and Rae had folded the oversized envelope into a jacket pocket and gone to join her granddaughter on the wind-blown deck. But she remembered Tamara's face as she'd reached for the check. It bore the same expression, that of defiance glued thickly over a vestige of shame, that Rae knew it must have borne as the Orca Queen rounded the island to the open strait. The same expression Rae had seen for the first time 6 months before Petra's birth, when she had gone to visit the newlyweds and set off an explosion. She could no longer reconstruct what the original disagreement had been about, what precise words had passed between her and Tamara. What she did remember vividly were two things. The first was an emotion, the despair of realizing that Tamara was truly lost to her, that all hope of a mature restoration of some mother-daughter openness had vanished. The second memory was visual. Don, standing in the doorway of the decrepit apartment with his arm around Tamara's shoulder, holding his new wife close to his side. Tamara looked terrible, her hair limp and unwashed, blotches of pregnancy-generated acne accentuating the flush of the recent argument, and a gauntness to her that testified to living on saltine crackers and herbal tea. Don, on the other hand, was bursting with health, and his gaze held Rae's in an unequivocal challenge, as if he had said aloud, "She's mine now. You'll only have her if I let you." And so it had proven over the years, with Tamara and even more so with Petra. Tamara had never given Rae an opening. That relationship was apparently beyond recovery. Petra, however. Within weeks of her birth, Petra became the battleground for a grim and completely unacknowledged struggle between an amused Don and a desperate Rae. Tamara, to give her credit, stayed out of it, but Don had mastered the art of using Ray's love for the child to keep his mother-in-law in her place. Tamara's rigid spine and Petra's waving arm on board the Orca Queen said it all. And for that wave, Ray would give everything. The new resident of Folly looked down and realized that she had continued picking up garbage unawares, and that her glove was currently gripping a flaccid, mud-caked condom. With an exclamation of disgust, she flicked it into the bag, then stripped off the glove and threw it in after. With fastidious fingers, she tied shut the top of the bag, dropping it in the lee of the lumber pile, and went back to the fire to scrub her hands with a lot of soap. Then she returned to her interrupted meal. The chili was scorched into the bottom of the pan. As Ray scraped the edible portions onto a plate, her awareness of how alone she was continued to grow. She began to feel like a pea on a platter. As she turned to carry her dinner over to the chair, the corner of her eye caught on a motion, and she jerked upright. But it was only the wavelets on the beach, no cause for her heart to race so wildly. She sat with her back close to the tent wall and picked at the scorched red mess, feeling invisible eyes crawling up and down the back of her neck like some many-legged creature, or like a man's fingers. She put her head down, forced her hand to lift the fork, forced her attention to remain on the food, demanded that her mouth eat it and her stomach receive it. Most of it. She was scraping the uneaten remnants into the flames when the dish slipped from her nerveless fingers into the coals. In snatching it up, Ray brushed her hand against the searing metal grill. With a sob of fury, she hurled the plate into the bushes and cradled her hand to her chest, eyes tight shut. The drugs in her knapsack called to her, but she had other plans for them. Instead, she rummaged furiously through the boxes of equipment piled near the tent until she came to the heavy leather brush-clearing gloves. With her blistered thumb in her mouth and the gloves in the undamaged hand, Ray stalked up the hill to her foundation. Two. Desmond Newborn's Journal. June 27, 1921. There are times, rare and precious times, when we lowly creatures are vouchsafed a glimpse of providence at work, the sure knowledge that there is a machinery connecting the disparate fragments of our lives, binding ugly to lovely, despair to rejoicing. How else to explain the train of events that brought me here? Overheard snatches of conversation in a bleak railway yard, my very presence there traced directly back through the events in Boston to the hell of the Western Front, and before that the strange urges that drove me to uniform in the first place, all linked, all the decisions, foolish, well-intentioned, and wicked alike, all the accidents, both the sweet and the bitter, leading me in a most circuitous pathway to this place. I stood today with my boots planted on the rocky entrance to a piece of land rising from an amiable sea, and I began to feel a most peculiar sensation, as if I were waking following a long and terrible dream. Or it may be that I am, in truth, sinking into a midsummer night's dream on an enchanted isle. If that be so, I pray God I may never wake. Three. The house that had once stood on these stones was built by Ray's great-uncle in the 1920s. Desmond Newborn, younger son of a wealthy Boston family, had read the poetry of Wilfred Owen and Rupert Brooke, embraced their romantic idealism of protecting England from the Kaiser, and sailed off to London in the summer of 1915 to enlist in the British Army. He even went as a common foot soldier, without the officer's rank his education and privilege would have bought him. He survived nearly 3 years of the carnage to be shipped home, alive but profoundly damaged, at the age of 27 years. He was by then far, far older in spirit. Rae was 9 when she discovered that Grandfather William had once possessed a younger brother. Had somebody merely told her, she would have laughed aloud at the very idea. A person might as well suggest that God had an auntie. Instead, Rae had compiled the unavoidable evidence on her own, beginning one morning when she was, as Cook called it, moping around the house. As often, on days when she was left to her own devices, this spindly girl with sleeping problems and a habit of silence, she was drawn to Grandfather's study. The warm, busy life of the house, particularly for a solitary child, might lie in the kitchen, but the true center of power was Grandfather's study. If Rae were to be caught there, she knew the punishment would be severe, but it was worth the risk to stand in possession of that room, with its smell of cigars and strong drink and William himself. It was not that there was much to do or see in the study. The books on the shelves were too thick to be of interest, the papers on the big desk incomprehensible, the 2 paintings dull. But climbing into Grandfather's leather-upholstered desk chair was so daring it sent her heart racing, and a glimpse of the world from his side of the desk made her see herself differently. Usually she just touched his pen, careful never to move it, dandled her feet for a minute, tugged automatically at the locked drawers without expecting them to open, and crept away again. Only this day, one of the drawers was open. Not much, just enough that the desk's central latch had not caught it. Rae shot a glance at the door, then dropped to her knees to ease it all the way out. More papers. How disappointing. But wait. Underneath the files was a lump, and lifting the edge of a slim ledger, she saw a wood-handled revolver and a flat leather box. The gun she left in place, but the box was too intriguing to ignore. She took it out to lay it on the carpet, fiddled with the latch, and swung back the hinged top. The box held a piece of metal with some faded ribbon attached, the sort of thing she'd seen Grandfather's friends wear on their uniform chests in the Veterans Day parade. And folded small, a piece of paper, some kind of official form, with spidery writing and the word enlistment at the top. None of the words meant much to her other than Boston, Massachusetts, but she was greatly puzzled by the name it bore, Desmond Newborn. There was nobody by that name in the Newborn family. Studying the paper gave no further clues, so after a minute she folded it away, closed the drawer as it had been, and slipped out of the room. Through judicious questioning, she found out from Cook what enlistment meant, but there was only one way to learn who Desmond Newborn was. Years later, it occurred to Rae that, given a more normal home life, she would have asked her parent. At the time, she never even thought of approaching anyone but Grandfather. William Newborn was, after all, the source of all power, every decision, all authority. And if the question was as important as she felt it might be, everyone else would consult William before answering her anyway. She knew the risks, or thought she did. It was never an easy matter to approach Grandfather, no knowing if he would respond with his standard brusque but dutiful paternalism or something darker or more violent. In this case, his reaction was violent indeed. In fact, she had never seen him react as he did to her innocent question. No sooner had she pronounced the strange name than William rose to his terrible height and stormed around the desk to roar down into her face, lashing her with a fury of words more terrifying than any blow from his hand. "Desmond, is it? Who the hell's been blabbing to you about that worthless ne'er-do-well? Who? Tell me, girl!" She pressed back into her chair, as if to make as small a target as possible against his wrath, her body rigid with shock. He continued shouting, "My God! I have no respect in my own house! It was the servants, I suppose, chattering about something that's no business of theirs.
Not that it's your business either, girl. Desmond Newborn was my brother, a shiftless good-for-nothing who went off and volunteered for somebody else's war, got himself shot up for his pains, came back here and lived off my sweat until he could walk, and then to show his gratitude took to the road like some damned hobo. In and out of jail, never a job. The last I heard of him was a letter 2 months before the crash, and that's the last I ever want to hear of him. Do you understand me?
Rae seized this crescendo as a command to depart. She scuttled from the room with as much dignity as her 9-year-old self could muster, wrapping pride around her like armor until she had reached the safety of her bedroom, at which point she crawled into the bottom of her bed and let go, sobbing until she hiccuped at the terror and fury, the outrage and injustice of Grandfather's response. "I was just asking a question," she whispered to herself over and over. "I just wanted to know." By the time Cook came to look for her, Ray's young mind had settled on righteous indignation. She did not speak to her grandfather for 2 days, which he actually seemed not to notice, and never again dared ask him about his brother. But the sheer, unwarranted force of William's reaction guaranteed that Desmond Newborn became a permanent resident in Ray's young mind. Once she had recovered from the shock, she found Desmond lurking in the background, a curiosity and an enigma. He became a sort of imaginary friend, confidant to her secrets and problems, unseen protector and bulwark against God's wrath. He helped Rae keep her chin raised whenever William blew up at her, helped her look her grandfather in the eye when she wanted to crawl away and tremble. By her 10th birthday, Rae desired nothing better than to be a ne'er-do-well herself, whatever that was. She never again approached William about the subject, never saw the leather box again until she inherited it, but over the years she pieced together a few facts about her secret companion. She chose her informants cautiously, relatives and family employees who would not instantly report her interest to William, and discovered that there had been an earlier war than the one in which Cook's son had died and the young gardener had fought, Desmond's War. When she was 12, she found a book in the public library about the terrible conditions of the soldiers in the First World War, but it only puzzled her the more. Given what she learned, she would have thought that the nobility of Desmond's voluntary enlistment, followed by honorably received wounds, would have made him a shining legend throughout the generations. Instead, before Rae was even born, the family's collective memory had shied away from Desmond, retreating into that vagueness that signals extreme discomfort. His croix de guerre was locked away in William's drawer, his injuries referred to so obliquely that as a child, Rae had believed it to mean that his face was horribly disfigured. As an adolescent, she concluded that he must have lost his genitalia. Only as an adult, after poring over the diary kept by William's wife Lacey, which was unfortunately little more than a laconic record of family events and household expenses, had Rae glimpsed the truth. That what Desmond left on the Western Front was a portion of his mind. That was the shame for which his family could not forgive him. After Desmond had recovered from his body's wounds, convalescing in the chilly family mansion near Boston, where Rae had spent most of her own childhood, the ex-soldier, as Grandfather had said, took to the road. Desmond Newborn would appear on the doorstep of one or another of his widespread relations and roost with them for a few weeks, usually in the cold months when pneumonia or just bronchitis laid hold of his weakened lungs, a legacy of the trenches. Then he would pack up his rucksack and disappear again, quartering the country, heading gradually west. Buried among Lacey's dutiful recording of weather and health, the baby's milestones, and monies spent on dresses and gifts, William's wife would note an occasional sum wired to her brother-in-law in Louisville or Chicago or Boise. Once, without comment, her copper plate handwriting recorded that bail had been provided on a vagrancy charge near Houston. Later, in early 1921, more jail monies were provided, only this time not as bail. Rae had never found out why Desmond had spent 6 months behind bars, but she knew that Lacey had sent money and a parcel of warm clothing, with no information in her diary other than the address of the Yakima jail. Then, the following summer, the wanderer had washed up in the San Juan Islands in the state of Washington, about as far from Boston as a person could get without crossing a sea or a border. Here Desmond Newborn found a home at last. Here he bought an island, a transaction not recorded in Lacey's diary, so it must have come under William's jurisdiction, and built his Folly, an oddly elegant little wooden house nestled between two highly idiosyncratic stone towers here on this string of cold, remote, and at the time sparsely inhabited islands on the crumbling edge of a continent. And here he lived with the seabirds and the orca whales for company until the wanderlust grew up again and took him off a few years later. At some point, no one seemed to know exactly when, the house caught fire and burned to the stonework, and both the island and Desmond Newborn's shadowy legend were absorbed back into the family pool. Since that time, the island had remained uninhabited, temporarily deeded to the state as a wildlife sanctuary, with the ownership and Desmond's medals coming to Rae on the settling of her father's estate 5 years before. It was this strange, bereft remnant of a house, more than any other thing, that had anchored Ray's climb from madness. Last May, 5 months after the accident, and 4 after the attack, Ray's mind had begun with great reluctance to unfurl from its tight retreat. In spite of herself, she started to take notice of her surroundings, the noise and disruption of the hospital, the tyranny of the drugs, the press of people and walls and cigarette smoke, a turmoil as great as that inside her mind. She began to seek out the quieter corners of the hospital grounds, craving solitude as a desert traveler thirsts for water. And like that traveler, Rae had eventually glimpsed solitude, and more faintly, purpose, a tool in the hand and the ability to concentrate on its use, flickering and wavering in the distance, as ethereal as a mirage and every bit as compelling. Except that the thought of returning home, the very idea of stepping into her fragrant and expectant workshop attached to a house that reverberated with emptiness, made her shiver with a mixture of desire and terror. Into this tangle of inchoate yearnings and inexpressible fears had dropped a book, one of those strangely assorted and badly worn paperbacks abandoned by patients or donated by the carton to places such as mental hospitals. It was missing its cover and the first dozen pages, but the remainder fell into Ray's confused and heavily sedated mind like a seed into loam. A man had built a house. An untrained and remarkably incompetent man, who would have reminded Rae of her first husband David, except that this man was so cheerful about admitting his incompetence, had made for himself a shelter, a roof, 4 walls, a floor. In the incestuous manner of writers, his purpose seemed to be not so much the creation of shelter as the opportunities the building process gave for self-reflection, and it went without saying the publication of a book about both building and self-reflection. But in reading it, Rae saw only the dream given form, the creation of house out of thought. She read and reread the book until it went to pieces. She could still recite long passages from memory. Like a seed, or a lifeline. Great Uncle Desmond's skeletal home came to her as in a dream. In truth, during those months, most things came to her as in a dream, but this one did not fade. Instead, it blossomed swiftly into full potential. She would pull herself together, she would go and rebuild Desmond's house, she would lift his walls and dwell within them quietly all the rest of her day. Everything that house was lay there waiting for her to take it up. House as shelter, house as permanence, house as a continuation and a legacy, comfort and challenge, safety and beauty, symbol and reality joined as one. While Ray's body wandered the hospital halls and grounds, her mind walked through the rooms she had known. The coldly formal dining room of her childhood home and the warmth of its nearby kitchen. The oddly shaped attic room of a bed and breakfast she had stayed in near Oxford, and the gilded ceilings of the palace at Versailles. The tracery of Gaudi's Sagrada Familia in Barcelona, and the cramped door frames of Wright's workshop in Scottsdale. She pictured herself in each one, saw herself in the process of hanging that dining room's awful wallpaper, troweling on that attic's plaster, building those rooms, and eventually, as a logical endpoint, the remembered and the imagined merged. Desmond, the mysterious lost relative who had intrigued her youth, stood beside her as she laid board upon board, making the house on Folly anew. Desmond, the family's other black sheep and the shadowy companion of her childhood, returned now to muse with her. How to get that roof up, all on her own? How to stand those walls, mount those windows, lay those shingles? Desmond, of whom William had disapproved almost as ferociously as he had Rae, walked with her through Folly until she could envision each step of the rebuilding process, one following another, no flaws. Desmond, fantasy guardian and companion, would be with her. It had seemed so simple at the time. Now, standing at the edge of a Pacific Northwest jungle with the painful throb of a burned finger to distract her, just pushing her way through to Folly's derelict front steps looked to be a challenge. Rae had no intention of beginning the ground clearing at this hour with the first intimations of darkness gathering in, but she also did not want to go to bed without having at least glimpsed the foundation. Gingerly, painstakingly, she threaded her boots through the wet vegetation, most of which seemed to have thorns, wading her way up the low slope until her toe hit something more solid than stems. She plunged a gloved hand deep into the greenery and tugged blindly. The rich odor of broken plant and torn soil rose up, and she pulled again and again, until there they lay, looking like a stairway leading through the jungle to a Mayan temple, Desmond Newborn's front steps. Rae gazed up at the four wide, immobile granite slabs. Stone was a medium foreign to her, a woman who had spent most of her adult life in a dialogue between the organic subtleties of wood and the ever-present danger of wickedly sharp steel. But there was no doubt that rock like this spoke of another world entirely, one of eternity, imperviousness, and utter solidity. She put a foot gingerly on the lowest step, rocking her weight back and forth. The step did not budge. Scuffling some of the generations of leaf mold to one side revealed a mottled gray surface, finely textured. The next step was equally solid, and the third. Shoving a pile of rich soil off the end of the third step, Ray's boot encountered something hard among the brambles. She burrowed through blackberry canes as thick as her thumb and rose stems hairy with thorns, and found herself looking at a slab of milled wood nearly 2 inches thick, dark with age but otherwise well-preserved. She ripped and yanked, hesitant to commit her leg to leaving the steps, but curious to see what this immense plank might be. After a few minutes, she had cleared one corner of it, a hand's breadth in both directions. The rest disappeared into a mass of vegetation. She grabbed the object and wiggled it from side to side. A lot of the growth moved in response. Without a concerted daylight effort, there was no guessing the final measurement, but Rae looked from the steps to the wood and concluded that despite its inordinate thickness, this was likely to be Desmond's front door, fallen here when the house burned away from it. She knelt on the granite and stretched out to shove the growth from the lumber's upper edge. A foot from the bottom, her gloves found an enormous iron hinge. Rae was smiling when she drew back her arm. Desmond's door. Who would have expected even a corner of it to have survived? She yanked off both gloves and pulled the knife from her tool belt, snapped open the blade, and stretched down to shave a thin layer from the door's edge. Her hands seemed certain of the grain's direction, even if her eyes couldn't see beneath the dirt, and indeed, as the blade traveled down the plank toward her thumb, the wood curled obediently over it. She caught the wide shaving and held it up to the fading light, noting its red interior, then put it to her nose. Beneath the earthy smell lay the faintest ghost of a tang, western red cedar. She studied the revealed grain for a moment, caressing its fine, dry texture, then slipped the curl into her shirt pocket before standing up and giving the protruding corner a last speculative glance. Then she retreated. Back at the fire pit, she threw some wood onto the coals to heat water for the dishes, retrieved her dinner plate from the arms of a bush, and washed up, taking care to lock away all traces of food. She was still hyper-conscious of the unaccustomed noises around her, aware of the twitchiness of her muscles and every motion of the waves, but it was not as bad as it had been earlier. Perhaps uncovering the stones had helped. Nothing like a ton or so of granite to lend a touch of reality to an enterprise. Maybe the unexpected glimpse of Desmond's own woodwork steadied her, or it might have just been the consumption of food that brought her down to earth. Whatever the reason, she now felt strong enough for the next step. She picked up the green knapsack and took from it a mashed white paper bag with the name of a pharmacy printed on the front. The sky had cleared while she wasn't looking, particularly out toward the western horizon. The undersides of the clouds now glowed rosy with the angle of the sun. Sticking the flashlight into an empty loop of the tool belt, she carried the paper bag down across the beach to the rock promontory and nearly leapt into the cove at her left when a pair of heavy objects splashed into the open water to her right. She peered, trembling, at the water, and a moment later burst into nervous laughter as two drowned-looking heads popped up from the water, harbor seals, disturbed from their perch by her passing. They looked up at her reproachfully with their liquid eyes. "Sorry," she told them. The two gleaming heads sank back beneath the surface, and Rae somewhat nervously continued on down the promontory. She reached the end without further mishap, chose a rock facing due west, and settled down to watch the sunset paint the sky. Desmond Newborn, she mused, might have sat on this same rock, watched that same sun go down in a blaze of oranges and blues. Well, perhaps not this very rock. Adding boulders to the promontory had been one of the few actions Ray's father had taken during his 20-year stewardship of the property, to keep the point from eroding and opening up the island's only cove to the sea. And Rae felt quite certain that Great-Uncle Desmond had not sat down here in order to open a paper bag and take out 6 giant plastic pill bottles. Sleeping pills, tranquilizers, mood regulators, mega vitamins, on the off chance that theory was not entirely bunk, she lined them all up on a rock between her feet. The sleeping pills first. She wrestled off the childproof cap and slid a forefinger in to pull the first tablet up the side of the bottle, held it for a moment between finger and thumb, then flicked it away into the water. It disappeared with a small plunk and a sinuous spread of concentric circles, as did the next and the one after that. It occurred to her belatedly that heavy-duty tranquilizers might not agree with sea life. Oh, well, maybe they would dissolve before the fish found them. In any case, tonight the fate of the local wildlife was not her main concern. When the last sleeping pill had been swallowed by the sea, she screwed the cap back on and returned the bottle to the bag, wholesale poisoner of fish she might be, but she was not going to be accused of littering, before reaching for the Prozac. Those pills made a slightly different sound, more of a plink. And the giant megavitamins made a plonk, but they too vanished beneath the gentle undulations of the water, and they and the rest were all gone before the last banner of orange had faded from the horizon. Now she possessed nothing more lethal than 100 aspirin tablets and a bottle of very old scotch, 2 things any normal woman might have. Pretend normality was Ray's current credo. She was sick to death of pills and control exercises and dream analyses and the overriding magnifying glass approach of psychiatry. She'd come to envision psychotherapy as first cousin to the debriding horrors of the burn wards, taking control of the healing process by ripping away the body's attempts at scar tissue, no matter how excruciating. Demons needed confronting, yes, but not every hour of the day. Avoidance was, after all, a coping technique. So now she would treat her problems with a healthy dose of avoidance, even if psychiatric truth declared you can't hide, you can't ignore. Bullshit, normal people did every day. The rebellious thought made her a little happier. The absence of pills frightened her a little, but that was only to be expected. Fear was normal, too. beneath a sky of deepest indigo with the full moon rising and her pharmacological boat sunk behind her, Rae took out the flashlight and picked her way back to the tent along the unfamiliar shore. Four. Rae's Journal. March 31. I wonder if anyone but me has caught the significance of this date. Not only the night of the full moon, when lunacy is at its fullest, but the eve of April Fool's Day as well. The hunter surely would have been on it in a flash, but as far as she's concerned, I left California on the Ides of March, which carries a very different sort of symbolic content. Give her credit, though. She might even be encouraged if I'd told her I was aiming for this date to begin my folly. A sense of humor indicates a healthy degree of perspective. But I haven't told her anything of substance for weeks now. Poor, well-meaning woman, I must send her a postcard. The date is a private joke. Alan would have appreciated it if he were here, but then Alan living would drain the joke of meaning. I first saw the island 5 years ago, a few months after my father died. When his estate was divided up between myself and various distant relations, for some reason he had specified that the island be left to me. I knew vaguely that there had once been a house here built by my mysterious great-uncle Desmond, but no one I knew had ever seen it. So that summer, Alan and I decided to take a look at what I had inherited before putting it on the market. It was actually more an excuse for a holiday than anything else. Bella came with us. She was 4 and a half then, and I was just back from London, triumphant and exhausted. I knew I must have looked as tired as I felt, because while we were here, 3 different people referred to Bella as my granddaughter. Alan was livid, but really, how many women have babies at the age of 42? Talk about an April Fool. Anyway, we hired a boat in Roche Harbor to bring us out here. It's called Sanctuary Island on all the maps and deeds, and that's the only name I had ever heard for it. But when I told the old guy in the boathouse where we wanted to go, he scratched his head for a minute and then said, "Oh, you mean Folly." Alan was delighted. He'd once spent a summer with a college friend whose family had a Victorian folly in the grounds of their country house, a fake ruin, forlorn, and more than a little ridiculous, but appealing. The island's nickname came from the house that once stood here, although I've never known if it was because the house had something quirky about it, invisible in the only photograph I have, or because in ruins it looked like the fake in the garden of Alan's friend. More likely the latter. But in either case, Folly it was called by the locals, and from then on by us. The house, the Folly that I intend to rebuild, those stones that I plan on reclothing with wood and plaster, was built and burned in the '20s, and was long since jungle by the time we saw it. We came, Alan and Bella and I, and we saw, and we fell under its lonely spell. Our planned quick survey of the island stretched far into the afternoon, cut short only by Bella's hunger. We hiked around the surprisingly large island, found a beach and a fresh, clear spring, and eagles' nests and trees, and even a sort of mountaintop, well, hilltop clearing, where the world stretched on to infinity. No, we determined we would not be selling off this part of my inheritance. When Bella was a little older, when Alan and I had less pressing schedules, it would be a retreat. Not only a glorious summer holiday place, but a building with personality, a folly in its truest sense of extravagance and irrationality, madness in one of its more amusing manifestations. We began the lengthy preliminaries, legal wrangles, engineers' inspections, restoration permits. 3 and a half years later, before we could return to the island, they were both dead. I am here instead. Newborn's Folly. Only Alan would appreciate the joke. Five. With reluctance, Rae closed the leather covers of her journal and laid it to one side, next to the old revolver and its 6 bullets arranged tidily on the corner of the makeshift writing desk, that they might keep her company as she wrote. She leaned back against the reassuring lumps of the tool belt, taken off only when she sat down at the desk, then rubbed absently at the surgical scar along her left forearm, over the metal plate that made her arm ache when fatigued, when cold, and whenever else it damn well felt like it. She took her hand away and gathered up the bullets. The six of them fit neatly into a fist, six bullets that made a lovely, dull, metallic rasping sound when rolled around in a closed hand, like a mouthful of wet pebbles. She poured them into her other palm and picked one out. Soft, warm, gray lead at one end, cool brass jacket flaring into the base at the other. A simple thing, really, awaiting a tap in just the right place. She wondered if she shouldn't number them, carve Roman numerals in their soft nub ends so she could tell them apart. But that seemed too much like the list-making that marked her worst periods, so she warmed them some more and then arranged them back in their triangle, three on a side. Good little soldiers. The tent surrounding her was brand new, ordered from a catalog along with half the kitchen equipment and waiting for her in Friday Harbor. Petra had helped her raise it, making it clear that this was about the coolest thing ever, while Tamara looked on in growing disbelief that anyone could possibly consider it shelter. The air inside smelled of waterproofing chemicals, and the wrinkles in the canvas and the mesh windows were still crisp from the packing box. Rae had been glad to find all the poles in with it. Rae Newborn's family was not the sort to indulge in a camping holiday. The closest she'd been to the tenting life was a week with Alan in a canvas-roofed cabin in Yosemite. It had been cold. It was cold now. The walls shifted of their own accord, shivering when the air brushed against them. All the flaps were tied snugly across the windows, but the door was still crimped in spots and lay against the opening unevenly. Someone outside could, by a stealthy approach and sinking to his knees, peep in at her where she sat at the desk. Rae reached behind her to pull the hammer from its belt holster, placing it squarely on the desk in front of her. "There's no one out there." The canvas shivered again. A twig or a pine cone hit the peak of the roof with a slap. Rae's body tightened against the noise. She started in on the breathing and visualization exercises that would encourage the muscles to relax, wondering all the while, why did that twig hit the tent? Was it a twig, or was somebody throwing something? And will the next step be a branch, scratching the wall, even though there aren't any branches for 6 feet in any direction? And after that, a knock, or a noise like a key tapping on glass, only there's no glass window in a tent. Maybe the watchers will just lean against the canvas, lean in and push against my space here, pushing in on me until the aluminum tent poles bend and the wall. She stood up so abruptly the chair toppled over, then reached for the control of the hanging kerosene lamp. Its bright glow faded, the shadows grew soft and then dimmer, until with a small pop, the light died. This had always worked at home, the cocooned feeling of being in the dark, so those watchers in the light couldn't see in. What she had failed to take into account was that her campsite had no floodlights, no means of throwing up a barricade of light in the compound outside, just the moon. "That was stupid, Rae," she berated herself. "Now you'll have to wait until Ed comes to get enough lights to hang up outside. Half a dozen ought to do it, but not kerosene. That wouldn't be too safe. Propane ought to be better, although what a racket they'll make. And how long does a lamp burn on a propane canister anyway? No good if I had to go out in the dark and change the canister. Maybe the lamps could be put on one of the big canisters, like I'm using for the stove. Harder to hang, but you're not going to do that," Rae said aloud. The tent seemed to agree, relieved that it was not about to be set beneath a spotlight. Ridiculous trees strung about with dangling propane tanks. Everyone in the islands would come to see it. Planes would divert to look down at her. "It's dark. Get used to it." Rae felt her way over to the cot, and from there to the bedside table, two crates of builder's reference books that held clock and flashlight. She picked up the heavy metal tube, but instead of thumbing it on, she stood in the dark tent, listening and watching. The moon was still too low in the sky to illuminate the tent, which meant that it was also no protection against any watchers trying to creep up on her. She clicked the flashlight on to check the door, immediately clicked it off again. On, off. Which was worse? She wanted nothing more than to sit at the desk and write in her journal for the rest of the night, concentrating hard on ink and paper behind the shelter of the canvas walls until the darkness had been gotten through and dawn allowed her to buckle on the tool belt again. But writing was no solution. She turned on the flashlight, took Tamara's matches out of her pocket, and lit the lamp again. She glanced down at the small battery-run clock beside her neatly arranged cot and saw with despair that it was barely 9. Camp was set up, dinner dealt with, the tent's sparse furnishings arranged and rearranged, tea made and drunk so slowly the dregs had been stone cold, the journal written in, still it was only 9 o'clock. Keep busy. But doing what? Standing beneath the whisper of the kerosene lamp, Rae became aware of a rustle in the front pocket of her shirt. She worked a hand under her fleece pullover and pulled out the curl of red cedar she'd taken from Desmond's front door. It was a lovely wood with the tight grain of virgin growth and sure to have been taken from very near here. She turned it over in her fingers and put it down on the desk on the opposite corner from the wood-handled gun. Then, taking a deep and steadying breath, Rae turned her gaze to the tent's zipped flap. Her heart began immediately to race, her lungs seemed to tighten, and even sitting she began to feel dizzy. Doom filled the air, the sense of imminent disaster built and grew in her very bones, until she'd have been certain she was having a heart attack had she not been through this 100 times before. Not outside. Oh, no, not at night. Yes, outside. I can't. You have to. It's why you came. But if someone's there, stupid, a canvas tent is no refuge, Rae told herself ferociously, and took a deliberate step so that her shadow fell on the tent wall, its curve of fabric strangely motionless now, despite the rising tempest. The darkness outside the screen pulsated with a throng of watchers, whispering and waiting to grab at her as soon as she emerged, to seize her and press themselves against her and pant obscenities in her ears. She could feel the bristle of unshaven cheeks scraping against her neck, hear the cheerful monologue of a dead child playing in the shrubs. She seized her hair with both hands. "I am 52 years old," she shouted silently against the rushing noise filling her ears. "I am the mother of 2 daughters, the survivor of more than my share of hell. The earth is not about to crack open. There are not 2 men breathing down my neck. My heart is not about to stop, and I will not be reduced to cowering imbecility by a panic attack. I will not!" Rae grabbed her heavy jacket from the makeshift hook on the tent's internal frame, wrestled open the door's long metal zipper with icy fingers, and stepped out into the non-existent tumult with the effort of an Arctic explorer entering a blizzard. Abandoning the revealing circle of light, Rae Newborn stumbled out into the darkness. She tripped twice, nearly sent sprawling by unseen obstacles on the uneven ground, before she found the soft trunk of the fallen cedar that drew a line between her living quarters and the island's forest. There she huddled, head down, fighting to wrap the feeble breathing and visualization exercises around the attack, waiting for the great body of the wave to break over her and retreat. It did, eventually. The sensation of being a small candle in a gale slowly gave way to steadying reason. The blood ceased to rush so furiously through her veins, her vertigo ceased its whirling, and she did not faint. The groans in her throat stayed behind her teeth. After a time, Rae sat up, bone-weary, and dashed both hands against her eyes. The urge to run blindly into the forest, or the sea, or traffic, to abandon the burden of rational thought for pure mindless panic was at times close to overwhelming, if for no other reason than the chance it offered for being knocked into blessed unconsciousness. It was to avoid the temptation of oblivion that she'd stopped driving. She well knew why the sensation of panic, demeaning, unpredictable, and completely pointless, was named after Pan, flute-playing tempter of the woods and meadows. Still, when the attack passed, it was over until the next time, leaving the victim languid and relieved and ready for sleep, like a recurrent fever, she thought, like some mirror image of sex,
And with that, Alan was there at her side.
Rae grieved for Bella, and she ached for Alan every day. Losing them had left two gaping holes in her, one bearing the outline of Bella's vigorous little body, the other Alan's solid bulk, holes of whistling emptiness with the chill of utter vacuum. Bella's joyous greeting, "Mommy!" was so thoroughly a part of her that she heard it still, heard it with the same conviction that causes a woken sleeper to lie straining for the echo of the disturbance, knowing without question that the sound was real, not a dream. "Mommy!" with its nuances of excitement or alarm or sheer ecstasy would shoot through Ray's hearing while she was reaching for a newspaper, pouring a cup of coffee, turning a page, dropping off to sleep. And, of course, overhearing the actual cry of a living child to its mother shuddered through Rae like an electric shock. With Alan, the loss was both more pervasive and less immediate. It came to her as the impulse to turn and tell him something, or the need to be held by his arms or buoyed by his infectious laughter, as the skin of the hand recalling his tight cap of curls and the coolness of his long, fine fingers. Every day for the last 15 and a half months, the loss of those two people had continued to ambush her, knocking her to her knees with stark, ever-fresh disbelief, and although the sharpness and the duration of these ambushes was fading, that was in its way almost worse. Alan and Bella were no longer moving easily through her mind. Once she could have conversations with Alan, play games with Bella, more or less at will, or with as much will as a mental patient can muster. Now when they appeared in her thoughts, they were oddly static, frozen in attitudes she had once loved. Even their outlines were pale. She was losing them for good, and she did not know if she could bear it. Another reason for the gun in her knapsack. Two wary people, Rae Newborn and Alan Beecham, both long divorced when they met, both parents of grown children they felt they had failed, yet despite their wariness, the bond between them was instantaneous and permanent, a jolt of current that crackled between them when, of all clichés, their eyes met at a gallery opening for a painter friend of Ray's. They left the gallery together. 4 days later, Alan proposed, and they were inexorably embarked on the conversation. Rae had been cold with apprehension, but she had no choice. Alan had to know what he was facing. "Monopolar depression," she told him. "Not bipolar, that's manic depression. Mine is just the downs." Melancholia was the old name. Winston Churchill called it his black dog. "It's scary, Alan."
"I can imagine."
"I mean for the people around me. For me, it's like being suffocated and having to act like everything is fine. From the outside, I begin to look like a zombie. Flat affect, they call it. Food, sex, beauty, anger, life, work, everything goes dead. Inside, it's pure agony, unrelieved pins and needles grimness. Physical pain is nothing by comparison. It's why so many depressives commit suicide, because the pain gets to be more than you can bear. She cleared her throat and forced it out. "I've tried to commit suicide twice."
"Jesus, Rae. Isn't there medication?" he'd asked helplessly. "Prozac, that sort of thing?"
"Sure. Some of it even does some good. But they all need a long time to take hold, weeks even, and when they do, I turn into a nice, cheerful vegetable. Even relatively mild drugs like Prozac work in the brain by suppressing dopamine, which is linked to creativity. A whole side of me goes numb."
"I see."
Rae had heard the brief phrase and knew with a terrible conviction that what she was telling Alan was too much, that Alan wanted out of the conversation, out of the whole brief, magical, doomed relationship. She made herself go on calmly, although she wanted to rage and weep. "But the worst part for me and everyone around me is the transitional times. I hallucinate. If you imagine depression like a part of the body going to sleep, your hands say, I go through these times that are the equivalent of the tingling before and after the numbness sets in. It's like my mind tingles. I hear snatches of voices, I glimpse movement that isn't there, I smell things. My fingers imagine strange textures. What? Alan looked lost, casting around for the proper response, and being Alan, he retreated into ideas. Rae heard his strategy as a death knell. I'm sorry, I don't know much about the disease. What do they think causes it? A mix of chemistry and life. The tendency is often inherited. Early life experiences affect it. Losing a mother when you're young is common among depressives. And growing up in an atmosphere where no one approves of anything you do, that doesn't help. But basically, nobody knows. Alan had gone home not long after the conversation. Rae heard the door close, reached for her glass, and drank herself into oblivion, absolutely certain she would not see him again. The next morning, she forced herself out of bed, forced herself to eat and shower and behave as if she still had a life. She was sitting, staring miserably at a slab of teak when his knock came on the door. He had a piece of paper in his hand. He thrust it at her and asked, "Is this what you mean?" Confused, she took the paper and read what was written on it. "In the middle of life's journey, I found myself in a dark wood where the straight way was lost. As one who has escaped, labored of breath from the deep to shore, turns to those dangerous waters and looks back." "What is this?" she asked him. "Dante, the Divine Comedy. I thought it sounded like what you say you go through. A dark wood where the straight way is lost." "It sure does." "Well, if Dante can survive it, so can we. A folie à deux." They were married 2 weeks later, and in the 9 years and 12 days of their life as husband and wife, no argument persisted overnight, no parting went without a phone call, and neither of them was ever bored in bed. Even Rae's pregnancy, discovered a scant 3 months after the wedding, took them quickly from shock, through tentative acceptance, and into a deep sense of their daughter as a gift, as precious as she was unexpected. Rae's daughter, Tamara, might have been from another species to her mother. Alan's son, Rory, was so incomprehensible to his father that the two saw each other perhaps once a year, and always in Los Angeles on Rory's ground. But with Bella, the fates got things right. Their family was small but complete unto itself. And Rae still woke at night with her hand questing blindly along Alan's side of the bed, still heard his voice murmuring in her ear, felt his fingertips brush her hair, though he and Bella had been cold, scattered ash for 470 days. While Rae sat hunched over on the soft bark tree, holding the hand of Alan's memory, her eyes had adjusted to the dark. Not that much adjustment was required. The full moon was above the trees now, and the clouds had cleared away. She'd forgotten how bright moonlight was away from the city. She could have read a newspaper by the stark light that bathed her clearing. She could have sewn a seam or worked a piece of inlay, assuming that her hands could remember how to hold the tools. The lowest branches of the trees near her tent were lit by the diffuse, warm light of the lamp, but their upper reaches formed intricate black silhouettes against the pale sky. The night was still, no breeze stirring the branches. Rae shifted on her perch, faintly uneasy. Somewhere across the water, far away on a neighboring island, a dog barked 4 or 5 times and then went quiet. A tiny bat flitted through the clearing. A raucous night bird screeched, making Rae twitch. The coals in the fire pit hushed into ash. And a chorus of tree frogs, somewhere off in the woods behind her, croaked out their availability. A pair of owls hooted at each other on high and low notes. Soothing noises, all of them. So why was Ray's heart thudding so? And then the chorus of frogs cut off abruptly. Rae's head came up fast to listen, but the faint, even susurration of water on rock, tiny wavelets pawing at her beach, was the loudest sound in all of creation. Cold sweat broke out along her scalp, and the breath through her nostrils filled the night, heavy breaths that seemed to come from just in back of her shoulder, and in an instant hands would grab her from behind, and the slow-motion nightmare would play all over again, and the "No!" she broke in desperately. "This is not fear. Fear has an object. Fear makes sense. This is anxiety. Anxiety means choking. It feeds on itself. You know that. Anxiety has no rhyme or reason. There is nothing to fear here. There's no one behind me. There's no reason to strangle an anxiety. Solitude is not only what I want, it is my natural state. Anxiety is beside the point. Fear is..." The litany stopped as Ray's loud breath froze in her throat. A sound had come to her over the night air, a slow, distant throb, rising and falling, too indistinct to be called a noise. "Dear God," she thought hopelessly, "is this some new kind of hallucination? Voices in the walls and the touch of imaginary hands are not enough. I now have to draw up the sound of distant drums in the jungle?" She caught the idea before it could feed further into her anxiety and squelched it hard. "This is a new country to you," she lectured herself. "This could be an actual, true-to-life, audible to sane ears noise." No, not could be, it was. Without a doubt, this sound would prove to be some odd natural characteristic of the San Juans, mating calls of the whales, or a relative of those seasonal noises north of San Francisco that used to drive people nuts until they were identified as some kind of shrimp or mussel. Although it did admittedly resemble the haunting voices of months past, those endless non-existent sounds bumping against her eardrums, even if there were no words in this sound, and no emotion. Then a small branch cracked nearby, and Ray's entire body jerked around to face her attacker. Her heart leapt like a wild thing trapped inside her chest as she waited, head raised and jaw slightly open, for a repeat of the noise. When it did not come, the very silence seemed to nestle up to her and pluck at her skin. Her throat choked shut at the looming sky and the towering treetops, the uncanny hugeness of the tent, the sheer massive size of all the world's things. In a minute she would be a cowering mouse beside a gargantuan Olmec head. In a minute everything around her would take on the tingling wrongness of Picasso's thick-limbed women thudding along the beach, that smothering expansion of everyday objects that since childhood had sent her cowering beneath folded arms. "There is nothing to fear here," she told herself. "It's a raccoon. It's not going to attack me. Everything is normal." She said it aloud. "There are no attackers here. There are no watchers in the woods." Over and over, she repeated the words, and she might have made it, might have convinced herself, and gone nervously to bed, but before her pulse could return to normal, a third noise came, the sound she dreaded most in all the world, reaching out to plunge her into abject terror, a boisterous young male voice shouting over the roar of a motor. A boat, clearing the next island as a couple of her neighbors headed home, but all Ray heard was young male. Her nose was suddenly filled with the stench of young sweat. A ghostly hand insinuated itself through the front of her shirt, and thought fled. Ray broke and ran straight into the arms of Pan. Or straight into one of the panic god's trees. Agony jolted through her as a branch snapped back against the exquisitely sensitive scar tissue on the left side of her body. The pain rattled her from teeth to toes, and she folded up to lie curled tightly around herself on the cold, damp, soft ground beneath the tree, hugging her pain until it died away, and the sounds she made shifted from sharp, urgent gasps to moans, deep and despairing. Oh, what was she doing here? What the hell was she doing here when a couple of kids in a passing boat could send her off the edge by a shouted phrase? How could she possibly think she could do this? Just take the damn gun and put an end to it, Ray. Oh, God, she groaned. Oh, shit. Oh, hell. The thing about madness was it just took so damn much energy, and it was so thoroughly tedious in the meantime. Perhaps she would just lie here, in the nice, quiet shelter under the fragrant, drooping branches. She would lie still, hidden from sight, feeling the moss grow up over her, pulling itself one gentle, spiky tendril at a time, until it covered her like a blanket and turned her into a soft, green, passive, ray-shaped mound. What a lovely idea. The idea was lovely, but the ground was hard beneath the decaying leaves, and her middle-aged bones too stiff to put up with the position. Reluctantly, ruefully, she got to her feet and pushed her way out of the low branches, grateful to find that the only damage resulting from her flirtation with Pan were a lot of bruises and a bash on her face that had missed putting out her eye by inches. Shaken and aching, she picked her geriatric way over the uneven ground toward the calm and disinterested glow of the tent. She did not even pause to check that the male voices were gone. She crawled into her sleeping bag and lay curled there, slowly warming and feeling, if not safe, then at least not actively under threat, for the first time since she'd stepped off the Orca Queen. She studied the leisurely drift of the moonlight across her roof and imperceptibly slipped away into sleep. Dawn had not come yet when she woke, but it was not far away. The ceiling of the tent was a gray presence overhead, the tick, tick of the small travel alarm on its bedside crate, the only fissure in the stillness. Her bleary gaze rested on the clock's face, its luminous hands faintly visible in the growing light, and then she frowned and worked one hand out of the warm cocoon of her sleeping bag, wincing at the awakening aches, to bring the clock up to her face. 7 hours? She hadn't slept a 7-hour stretch in years, even with drugs. She put the clock down and drew her arm back inside and lay in her snug sack while the tent's furnishing slowly took shape around her. A dark blob indicated the kerosene lamp hanging from the ridgepole. A monolithic square represented the stack of plastic storage chests that functioned as a combination bedroom, closet, tool shed, and pantry, with the smaller shapes beside it of her locked trunk, the big metal toolbox, and the wooden box that held her fine woodworking tools. The top of the desk seemed to float off the ground, the slats of her wooden chair becoming visible against it. Soon she could make out the drape of her carpenter's belt, slung from the back of the chair as if a gunslinger had dropped it there. The head of the hammer began to gleam dully. Her bladder decided it was time to get up. The inside of the canvas was beaded with condensation, her boots were as cold and rigid as ice cubes, and she was very glad she had gone to bed more or less fully clothed. She worked a fleece pullover past the layers of polypropylene and cotton flannel she already wore, and tugged the knit cap Petra had given her over her short hair. Her fingerless gloves were in the pockets of her heavy jacket, somewhat protected from the cold, and she put them on before reaching for her old friend, the carpenter's belt, solitary companion on this mad quest. With all the clothes she wore, buckling the belt took some attention, and it rode nearly at her waistline instead of down around her hips. Still, the accustomed weight, the rattles and creaks of tools and leather, the pat of the hammer against the outside of her right thigh, and the press of the 3/4-inch tape measure against the small of her back, all made her feel more herself than anything in the world. The hammer at her right hip was one of the few things that connected the Rae who stood on the island with the Rae she had once been, 32 years before, when Rae had discovered in herself an unexpected taste for the physical act of building. A pregnant 20-year-old married to a man who hid his own manual incompetence behind a scornful derision of those he referred to as rude mechanicals, Shakespeare never having changed the oil in a car, and faced with a set of shelves that needed putting up, Rae had marched, or rather by that point in her pregnancy waddled, down the street to the hardware store and asked the salesman what she needed for the job. The cheap drill and screwdriver that she had bought that day had long since been given over to landfill, but a month later, looking at a slightly more ambitious project involving a piece of furniture in the baby's room and with a husband even more vocal about people who do it themselves instead of leaving it to the experts, all of whom seem to be on long jobs or on vacation, Rae found herself defiantly buying the most expensive hammer in the shop. It was a framing hammer, its short, strong claws nearly flat compared with a standard claw hammer's long curves, 21 ounces of drop-forged steel that was too much hammer for a woman, according to the store owner. Rae, however, was a big woman, tall and broad-shouldered. Besides which, she liked the way the hickory handle fit her hand, liked the way the exploratory swings woke up the muscles all along her right side, from fingertip to jaw and down to her hip. By now, the hammer, like its owner, had seen hard use. 10,000 nails had worn down the face and left a fine network of scratches over the head. But it still gave her strength, this tool that had stayed with her longer than anything or anyone else in her life. Husbands left or husbands died, daughters married avaricious jerks or daughters died. One's very mind wandered in and out of control, but two handles later, the 21-ounce hammer still fit her hand, still nestled reassuringly along the line of her pelvis. She smoothed her thumb along its icy steel head, pulled on her jacket, and let herself out of the tent. She stretched and yawned and scrubbed at her face, waking up and taking in her surroundings. This would be the view that greeted her every morning she lived in the tent. Close at hand, her kitchen, fire pit, storage boxes, camp stove, and living room, canvas sling chair, and two tree sections that could function as dining tables, footstools, or chopping blocks. The fallen cedar on her right that kept the wilderness at bay and drew a line down to the promontory. The clearing to her left, a rough oblong, too scruffy to be called a meadow, its borders defined by the cove before her, the old madrona tree some 40 yards from her left shoulder, the burnt-out, overgrown foundations uphill from it, and behind the back wall of the tent, a barren, sharply rising rock slope. Beyond those, water all around. This morning the sky was a depthless expanse, high mist or low clouds. No birds sang, no wind moved.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.